Today we're going to do something we've never done before, and we're going to have a presentation by utilization of technology. Technology's changed tremendously since I started in education 42 years ago. And today we're going to have a presentation we could not otherwise have had. Years ago I was asked, what's your definition of a leader? I pondered the question and I determined that a leader is one who has a vision of something that needs to be done. A leader has the ability to articulate that vision to others and express it in a way that enables others to see it. A leader is one that causes others to want to participate in accomplishing that goal. 27 years ago, I met a person that possessed all of these characteristics. He inspired an athletic program, a school district, and a community to believe you could do more than you ever believed was possible. His leadership was contagious. He inspired a young, outstanding freshman by the name of Mark to become a quality athlete that went on to star at the University of Arkansas and play briefly with the Kansas City Chiefs. But he wasn't just concerned about the athletes. There were brothers who suffered physical defects, Josh and Ken. One used a motorized wheelchair, the other a cane. But on the day they were boarding to go to a semifinal state championship football game, the whole team had to wait because Josh was not going to make it down to see the team off because he walked slowly with his cane. The rest of the team waited on the bus while Coach went down the hall to thank Josh for his support. He inspired a young man who was just a common ordinary athlete, 5 feet 11, 170 pounds, who had the nickname of Moose, to play in the biggest game of the high school history, like he was 6'5 and 265 pounds. But another non-athlete was touched by Coach. That was Chester. Chester was a special needs student who knew and was proudly there every morning at 6 o'clock because he knew Coach would be there. And not only would Coach have donuts for himself, he would have donuts for Chester. And Chester would go with Coach down to watch film and do homework. He inspired another young man, a quality young man, who was a decent athlete, but because of his intelligence and hard work and character, he went on to become the first of 3 college All-American football players from the same family. And that young man now serves as superintendent of schools in the Republic School District in Missouri. And then there were 2 young ball boys in the 6th grade that weren't a part of the team, Brad and Craig. They proudly, with smiles on their face, served the team because they were a part of it. One now is a doctor, the other a lawyer. Jerry Kill has proven himself over and over again to be a difference maker in every program with which he has been connected. He came to our district and coached for 2 seasons, 1988 and 89, had a record of 25-1, and won the first state championship of any team in the school's history. He had come from Pittsburgh, but he went back and was offensive coordinator and led the team there to a national championship and a runner-up. I got a call one day from a place in Saginaw, Michigan. They were going to thinking about hiring Jerry Kill. What could I tell them? I said, he's the most contagious person I've ever met in my life. A few years later, I met the athletic director and I said, was I right? He said, he's even more than what you said. He took a team that had not had success and took them to national rankings while there. He returned home to Emporia, Kansas, because Jerry's a family man. His father was gravely ill and enabled him to coach near his father. Leaving there to go to Southern Illinois, winning 1 game his first year. He won 55 while he was there, but in the last 4 years, he won 50 games. He went from there to Northern Illinois and then to Minnesota when it was not having success. In 3 or 4 years, he's taken the team to a bowl. What is it about a guy that goes to a team that is less than and makes it more than it ever believed it could be? Jerry's done that everywhere he's been. Commissioner talked briefly just a few minutes ago in a meeting about the APR. Everybody's heard about an APR. Jerry Kill has to produce an APR every year for his college athletes. And in 13-14 season, he had a 994 APR, the highest in Minnesota's history. So you see, he's also accountable for academic success of his students. In my library at home, I have read books on John Wooden, Vince Lombardi, and Bill Walsh. What did they have in common? They had in common the ability to take people and take groups of people to come together and to make them believe they could perform at a level greater than they ever expected and make all of those associated with the program realize they had an important role in what they do. Today, I place Jerry Kill personally among these great names because he has repeatedly demonstrated his ability to inspire his athletes on the team, to inspire those who are on his staff, to inspire his community, and through that inspiration, hard work, dedication, he causes them to believe you can do what you believe and dream that you can. It's my honor today to present through this Skype presentation Jerry Kill, head coach at the University of Minnesota.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate it. Can everybody hear me good? All right. It's good afternoon from the Twin Cities here in Minnesota. It's great to have the opportunity to visit with you. I apologize deeply not being there. You're kind of getting me started tonight because I have another presentation to give here this evening. But, you know, when Dr. Lankford asked me to be able to have the opportunity to visit with you, there's nobody that I respect more. And I've been in this business for 32 years than Dr. Lankford. And he's been the best administrator that I've ever had. And that'll probably get me in trouble since I'm here in Minnesota, but that's all right. You know, I am, you probably say, why is a guy that's a football coach, you know, talking to you all? And, you know, that's a question I ask a little bit. But, you know, I'm going to try to give you some things that through my experience as a coach that maybe can help you and help you as an administrator. Because, you know, down the road, you know, I'm not going to coach forever, but I'm going to work forever because I've got to stay busy. But, you know, I have aspirations to, you know, be a leader. I'm a cancer survivor, have a cancer foundation and, you know, go back and lead that foundation or even be, involved in collegiate athletics or, you know, assistant to the president. I've got a lot of dreams and goals, you know, left down the road for me. And, I'm looking forward to those. With that being said, you know, I kind of get into some things that I'll talk to you about what we've done at the University of Minnesota. I could talk to you about each stop. But before we get into that, you know, I get a chance to speak to companies here. We have 19 Fortune 500 companies, and, you know, it's a great place to live, and it gives me opportunities to do some things that I normally wouldn't get to do. For me, you know, my job and how things line up, I think whether it's a company, whether it's a school system, whether it's college football, it always starts at the top. And, you know, of course, here at the University of Minnesota, it starts with the state legislation. You know, then we have a board of regents. Then we have the president of our university. And, you know, then from the president of the university, we have an athletic director, and then comes Coach Kill. and from Coach Kill, we branch out, and then we have the players, the kids, which there's nothing more important than the kids. And I truly believe you have to be lined up from the top to the bottom to have success. And, you know, I just think that's a very important tool. If you go down that same list and went through what your responsibilities are, they're really the same because, you know, you get into it, you have the legislation, you have a board, you have a superintendent, you branch off to the people in the, you know, who's in charge of your English department, and then you branch off to the teachers, then the students. So there's a lot of, you know, similarities between all of us as leaders of where we go. With that, you know, in talking about that, let's talk about leadership before we get into some of the things that we've done. You know, I hope I don't offend anybody, but I'm always a straight shooter. And I always think about our players right now. You know, they're all guys that think they're going to go play in the NFL, and there's not going to be very many of those. You know, they're there to get an education. That's the most important thing they do. A lot of people come out of college and they think they ought to make $150,000 a year and be at the top you know, be the top of the organization. Well, you know, I don't think that's how it works. I started off being a graduate assistant at Pittsburgh State and lived in a trailer house and got paid $250 a month. And my wife worked at a TV station for $10,000. We did that for 3 years before I even got an opportunity to get into coaching with a paycheck, so to speak, and getting a chance at Webb City High School and worked my way through. But, you know, I did about everything you could do in college football before I got the job as a head coach at the college level. And I was able to be an offensive coordinator, defensive coordinator, recruiting coordinator. I'd been a head coach at the high school level. You know, I dealt with public relations. I worked as a residential person that did housing. So I had a lot of branches before I got started. And I think it's the same way when you talk about a good leader, that leader has to be very, very knowledgeable of what they do. I mean, they have to know their trait inside out. It's like somebody that owns a restaurant and they have no restaurant success, you know, never had any experience, and they go try to run one. I think one that's going to be more successful if that person started off in what they did, washing dishes, you know, and working through the process to understand the knowledge it takes to run that restaurant. And I think, you know, that's just an opinion of mine. But as I look at some of the young coaches that are coming into our business, they're jumping in before they have the experience. And then in our business, you get fired in about 3 years if you're not successful. So I think it's important before you jump in as a young person, listen to the people that have been there for a while and learn and absorb and be like a sponge when you have the opportunity to gain knowledge. With knowledge, you know, and Dr. Lankford's already talked about it, you have to show a vision. It doesn't matter where you're at or what you do or how tough the situation is, you have to show the vision of where you're going and what you're going to do. You know, our vision at the University of Minnesota, you know, the very first day I walked in, as I said, number one, you're going to get your education at the University of Minnesota. Number two, we're going to win the Big Ten. How are we going to accomplish this goals? Well, we're going to be tough. We're going to be accountable. You're going to go to class. You're going to be on time, and et cetera. But we laid out the vision of where we wanted to go and what we wanted to do. Not only did I have to show that vision to our players, I had to show that vision to the community, our state, and also our top people. So, you know, if you don't have a vision, I don't think you can be a leader. I know you can't. You know, you have to make tough decisions, certainly in the situation you all are in, and certainly in the position that I'm in. They're not always popular, but you can't worry about it. You have to make the best decision you can for the people that you're in charge of and for the school that you're working for. Just as I have to make the best decision for the Minnesota Gophers, the football program, and the school, because we're all part of one. And that's not always easy. I live up here in the Twin Cities, and we have a lot of media, and you're going to get pounded every day. You know, you can't worry about that. You can't worry about what people think. And at the end of the day, you got to do what's right. Adversity. You're going to have to handle adversity, you know, in anything you do. You know, your back's going to be against the wall. It may be a health problem. It may be, you know, something that's happened in your family. It's something in the school system. They cut all your money out of your budget. You got to make it work. You know, to me, all great people that are great leaders have been able to handle adversity throughout their lives. And it's going to happen. And instead of feeling sorry or feeling bad about the situation or in tough times, I believe you evaluate people by, you know, seeing what they do when their back's against the wall. When we won one game that year at Southern Illinois, I found out a lot about people and the kids, the community. I found out who was going to be there through adversity. And it made our team better because we ran off, you know, 5 straight years of 10 victories or more. But I was able to see how people handled adversity. And you have to be able to do that as a leader. The next thing, and I think people, well, you know, hey, being a role model is not that important. I believe it's one of the most important part of leaderships. You're at the top and you're in charge of all those people. And we tell all those people what we expect and want out of them to be successful. Yet, you know, sometimes we have leaders that don't hold their own self accountable. It's very easy as I coach here at the university, and I ask our kids to be on time, act right, be accountable, you know, those types of things. And I go out and I tell them, hey, I don't want you drinking in the bars. I don't want you doing that. And their head coach is down drinking at a local establishment with a bunch of people. You know, what kind of leader is that? You know, I have to me, you have to be uncommon to be a leader. You got to be different. And you lead sometimes by example or all the time by example to your people that you're working with. And if I could recommend a book, how many of you, and you raise your hand, have read the book Uncommon by Tony Dungy? I think it's one of the best books that's ever been written. And he happens to be a person that played here at the University of Minnesota. But it was a book about, you know, leadership and what he's accomplished, what type of man he is. And he was uncommon. I mean, he did things differently. And that's why he had been successful. The other thing I think we've forgotten to do in leadership, and here I am speaking to you through technology, but also technology has done some great things, but it also has done some things that I think aren't so good. I talk to our players all the time about social media and what they put on social media. I mean, and we don't recruit people from social media, what they put on there. And I always tell our players, why do you want to tell everybody what you're doing? You know, just do what you're supposed to do. You know, I talked about it when all the cell phones came out, and I had 2 daughters, and one would be downstairs and one would be upstairs, and they'd be texting each other. It drove me crazy. I go, what are you doing? You know, walk upstairs and see your sister. So what I think, as I'm leading into, is communication. I think emailing is great. I think all the modern technology is great. It's done so much to be able to educate people better, and that's where the world's going. But I also think something that's very important, and I see it all the time where I'm at, is somebody looking somebody in the eye and visit them with them. We get people in our profession that get fired through email. And that's something that to me is unbelievable. You know, I think there's nothing better and stronger than somebody sitting down and communicating what they want out of the people that they're working with, and communicate, you know, visibly every day. I think we've forgotten about that. And we talk to that about our players all the time, you know, and I just think it's something that's very, you know, important. And then the most important one that I've always talked about, I'm just a common guy, a common kid. I grew up in a town of 2,000 people. I'm the only person out of my family to graduate. I graduated from a college you probably never heard of, a place called Southwestern College in Winfield, Kansas, a place where, you know, we had 700 students, and I wasn't a superstar. I wasn't anything like that. And believe me, I never thought I'd be sitting in this chair. But my dad told me, you know, one thing. He said, you have a chance, son. And he said, one thing that will get you where you want to go someday is just flat hard work, just what I've asked you to do your whole life. And I think if you want to be at the top of the field that you're in, you have to work hard, and you have to get the people around you to work hard. And I think that's something I learned from my father, who's one of the most inspirational person or people in my life. With that being said, I will give you some examples from some places I've been. When I got the job at the University of Minnesota, and when you talk about college football and college athletics, is that, you know, usually when you get a job, you know, it's broken. There's something wrong with the situation. And we're kind of known as coaches on my staff, and where we're at is we're program builders. We go and build programs. And I got hired at the University of Minnesota 4 years ago. They haven't been very successful. They'd won way back. They'd won national championships all the way back to 1961. But they haven't won very consistently the rest of the time. Matter of fact, you know, we played January 1st was the first bowl game, I believe, since 1967 on January 1st. So we had a long way to go. When I went into the institution, the first thing I did, and what I've done with every job that I've had, I've surrounded myself with good people. And I've surrounded myself with people that could do things that maybe I didn't do as well. Sometimes I think as leaders, we have a big ego and we think we're going to do it by ourselves. That's not going to happen. You have to surround yourself with good people. I've assembled my staff all the way back to Saginaw Valley State. I have people that have been with me 21 and 22 years. Instead of going out and taking that all-star person as I moved up the ladder, I kept the people that were good and fit into the organization and was the right fit for Coach Kill and his program. And, you know, we have the longest tenured staff in college football right now. And I'm very proud of that. And of course, as we moved up the ladder, we've had guys go be head coaches, and we've had to move some new people in. But we always made sure they were the right fit for the school and where we are at and worked into our organization. So the reason we've been able to turn programs around is because we've been around good people, and I've been able to hire good people. And so that's important. There's no question. When I took the job, our guys came in. We didn't have to learn how to do it because we've been doing it the same way for, you know, many, many years. I just received a book about the Web City tradition and what they've done since I have been gone. And reading parts of that book in the chapters that I was in the book, the same principles I was using at the high school level are the same principles that I'm using today. There may be some things that have been added, but the principles haven't changed much. And we talk about academics. When you take a college program over, the thing that really, really you struggle with when you go in, every one of them that are broke and have academic problems. When I went to the University of Minnesota, they had 22 players on academic probation. 22. We had 4 players that were kicked out of school. I had to find a way with the APR. If we lost 7 players out of all those kids, then we'd have lost 7 scholarships and have been embarrassment to the university. So what are we going to do to change it around? We don't have the money Ohio State, Michigan, Penn State. You know, they play in 100,000 seat stadium. We play in one that's holds 56,000. You know, you add that up money figure wise, and there's a lot of difference. So what are we going to do to change the culture of what we're doing academically? How are we going to save an embarrassment? Well, I went in front of a board of academic people and begged them to give me the opportunity to to work with these four kids. And they gave me the opportunity. So that helped us. And then we had to change in a hurry. So we had to change the academic philosophy. And one of the things we did is we hired two people that were very, very good at what they've done, and people that, you know, associated and knew that would fit in. And with that, we invested, instead of just investing football money into football, we invested money into the academics, and we also got people to help us. You know, we got our kids computers, we hired more tutors, you know, all the things that we could do, you know, from that side of it to help us academically. And then the most important thing we did is we held them accountable. You know, if they weren't on time to class, if they didn't go to class, you know, they weren't going to play at the University of Minnesota. Now, you're talking about a guy that usually gets 3 years, and if you don't turn the program around, you're fired. So, but everywhere I've been, I've never worried about getting fired. I've worried about doing the right thing. So, you know, what we did, we even hired people to class check our kids, you know, coaches that were retired, to make sure our kids were going to class. If they didn't, then, you know, they didn't play. Our best corner my first year was in study hall during game day. Now, let me tell you something. When a guy's in study hall and you're playing in front of 56,000, that's not going to be a real happy young man. I will tell you that young man graduated and got a degree. And he's also came back and thanked me for what we did at that particular time. But we had to change the culture, and it was a combination of a communication and working together with the academic people. They did the work, but Coach Kill and our coaches held them accountable. Once a week, we got a report, and we went over that report. If we had a young man not doing good, then we made sure he got help. And, you know, we kept those kids accountable, and we worked together with the group of people. I can proudly say the last seven semesters at the University of Minnesota, we've had a 3.0 or above each semester. We have the, you know, one of the highest APRs in the country. It's probably what most people feel like is the biggest turnaround in college football from an academic standpoint. How did we do that? The same things I just talked about. Communication, working together, having a vision how we're going to change the academic system, you know, being hard on kids. I was not popular at the time, but I didn't care. I just wanted to do what was best for the University of Minnesota and our student athletes. So that's where we started from a, you know, I call it sound mind. They had to have a sound mind before, you know, we went any further than that. Then we went to the most, you know, the next step in our process is we had to build what we call, you know, a sound body. We were not a very strong football team. We weren't a very motivated football team. So we did things within the weight room with our guys and our strength guys. We made it stronger. I brought people with me. I kept people, and we worked together. And we looked at the vision we were going to do. We knew we weren't going to recruit against those kind of people. So what did we do? You know, we were going to take what we have, and we're going to do the best we could with it. And we didn't have the weight rooms and the facility, our day-to-day operations, you know, to be like everybody else. Now, we had a beautiful stadium that they just built, but we're over there 15 times a year. You know, our operations on the other side of the campus. With that, you know, you can sit around and complain and say you're never going to win and you're never going to have enough. Well, everywhere I've been, they had never given us a whole bunch. We had to prove we can win, and then we started getting the facilities that we needed to really turn the corner. So as a, you know, the CEO, so to speak, of the company that I'm in charge of, I had to work with the administrators. You know, I had to show them the vision, what we needed to win the Big Ten. Now, they couldn't give me everything they had because we don't have the money to do that. But through communication, we have moved the program forward. So, you know, we got, you know, we're getting there, but we still have what we have. And our kids, you know what? always tell them it's not the facility you work out in, it's what you get out of yourself within that facility. You know, it doesn't have to be the biggest. When I was at Web City, it wasn't the biggest. You know, hey, it's, again, what you do with what you have. If you're going to complain all the time about what you have, it brings in a negative attitude, and you're never going to turn anything around. You got to say, hey, this is our facility, name it the dungeon, whatever you name it, and make them believe we're different than everybody else and that we're special. We're the only Division I football program in the country at this point in time. Now, we're going to get a new facility, but we're the only one in the country that eats in a hallway for their training table, in a hallway. Nobody else in the country does that. And we've been able to turn the program around, and you know what? There's nothing we can do about it. We keep working with the administration to get the money raised. That's what I'm doing tonight, is going to a donor event to help us get the facility, which we think will open or start in October. But with, you know, the last 4 years, we had to win games before we were going to have that opportunity. So we ate in the hallway. What are you going to do about it? You do the best you can. So if we're going to eat in the hallway, we're going to eat the best food. We're going to get the best food. That's the most important thing. It wasn't the hallway. And, you know, so we got the best food and we ate in the hallway. And so that's what we did. That's what we had to do. You know, we didn't have the nicest indoor facility. A matter of fact, you know, the Big Ten Network, 2 years ago said we had the worst facility, operating facilities in the Big Ten. When we go into our indoor, it rains through our indoor. Again, what are you going to do about it? We don't have a lot of money, so you deal with it. And you tell the kids, that doesn't matter at the end of the day. You go to a school because it's the right fit for you educational-wise. And the second thing, you go to where, what school you're going to because of relationships and if you trust your coaches. You know, some of the colleges, there's a coach there 1 year and gone the next. We could prove that our coaches were going to be there because we could show them. So we built relationships in recruiting with those players to where they couldn't say no, and they forgot about the facilities. You know, they concentrated on what was important. And so we were able to recruit through great communication and building a relationship. So that was important. Now, you've got to get everybody on the same team. And, you know, we've got to get our state excited. We got to get our administrators excited. But you know what? To get them excited, you got to treat people good. Let me tell you something. It would mean a whole lot from an administrator, you know, or a head coach that walks in and he sees the guy that's the maintenance guy and he's mopping the floor in that place that you're eating in the hallway. You know what? He's as important as anybody else is, because if we walk a recruit in, that floor better be clean. Our building, even though it's not special and it's broken down, we're going to have it as clean as we can have it. Well, you know what? When you go in there and you give a sweatshirt or you pat the guy on the back or the lady on the back for the job they're doing, you're going to get a lot more out of them. I mean, they feel good. They feel like they're a part of the team, and they are. You know, your equipment managers in football, you know, they don't make a lot of money. They do it because they love what they do. But hey, maybe take them out to eat. Take their wife out to eat. Take them to dinner. Tell them how important they are, you know. And you'll be amazed at what happens to the culture of the people that work in that building and what they'll do for you. I mean, they will do anything because they know you care and they're a part of the team. And they are. I mean, you don't, let me tell you, if we lost our equipment guy or we lost the guys that clean our building, we're in trouble. I mean, we're in trouble. And I fight my tail end off for our people now. That's one thing people will tell you. Well, if we got good people, I'm going to keep them and I'm going to do everything I can to keep them, even if I have to take a lower cut in pay, because I'm only as good as the people that you work with. Then the next thing is, you've all been in a situation where you've gotten a job where you've inherited a just not a very good culture. Our culture within our football team was really, really bad. I mean, it was terrible. You know, I got hired there and we had kids in trouble about every week, and plus the academic structure. So we had to, you know, we had to take care of it, and we did. And it's a process, you know. With the APR, you just can't run people off, you know, because you do, then you're going to lose scholarships. So you have to work with what you have, and you got to find a way to get people to do what you want them to do. And you got to show them the vision. If they do the right things, what will happen? And in our process to change the culture, you know, we had to turn it into a culture where it was positive and people cared about it. When we recruited, the first class that we recruited, we didn't take a bunch of chances. You know, we took good people that fit into our organization because we had to change our locker room. And we changed our locker room by bringing in the recruits and our players that were good people. Now, sometimes they went the other way, but then you bring that second recruiting class in and the third. And now we have a great culture. Not that we don't have problems. We all have problems. Well, they're kids, you know. I have 118 kids right now on campus, and every one of them's got a situation that's different, you know. And so I've got to turn them into a team. Right now, we can bring freshmen in, and our culture's great. You know, our defensive secondary, we got a young man named Keontae Harden. He's from Webb City. I was worried about him getting homesick, going home in a week. Shoot, our secondary players are taking care of him. He's one of theirs, and he fits into what we want. Keontae didn't grow up with everything. I mean, he struggled. He struggled for a meal sometimes. And now he's up there. He gets to eat three meals a day. He thinks he's the greatest place in the world. And but he also fits in with our guys to give him the proper direction to where he needs to go. We changed that culture. And it takes a while. We've been able to do it in our third year for whatever reason, every place we've been. I thought this one would take us five. We still have a ways to go, but we're getting there. With that, we had to change the culture of the state. When I was at Webb City, we had to, you know, get our community involved with the team. When I took the job, I said, it's not Coach Kill's team, it's the state's team. I speak in the month of June. I spoke 22 nights in the month of June. And I spoke on those nights either raising money or selling our program. You know, I make it a point to be the most visible person in the state of Minnesota. I'm selling what we're doing. And at the beginning, nobody listened. They said, same old stuff. We've heard it for years. You know, they were just negative. You know, now we got people wearing Minnesota football, you know, stuff all over town. They're excited, but they didn't believe at first. And as a coach, again, you got to sell them the vision and their involvement and what you need from them. And, you know, they start to buy in. Now, you have to win. I mean, that's all part of it. You have to be successful, and you've got to work at it to win. But, again, we've been able to do that without the resources. Now, with that being said, sooner or later you need the resources. There's no doubt about that. But you have to work hard to get there. And then once you get the resources, then you can take the next step. But in the jobs that I've had, you had to take what you had and you had to have it, you know, be successful. And, you know, you got to care about people. You got to know them. You know, like our players, I'll go down and set an eat training table with them. I go down before they come out to the practice field, and I sit and talk to every one of them before they go out to the field. You got to get to know your people before you motivate them. And you're in a leadership responsibility, and each person that you deal with's got a different personality. You can't treat everybody the same. You have to treat them fairly. When I get in a locker room, or when I get in front of our team for the first time, I'm going to have kids from all over the country, all different backgrounds, all different races. Some of them don't have parents. Some only have one. I can't treat them all the same. So before I can motivate them or see what makes them go, or if I have to get on one really hard, or I got to be a little bit different on another person, then you got to get to know those kids. And I think it's the same way with employees. I think it when you're in a company and you're a manager of that company, if you don't get to know your people outside work, and all you talk about is work, you know, then I don't think you can get those people motivated. When we talk to players on the field, it's work. Off the field, I tell our coaches, I don't want you talking about football. Talk to them about their family. Talk to them how their day went. You know, talk to them how, you know, if they got any problems. You know, did you have a great day? All those kind of things. Again, I can't emphasize, get to know the people that you work with, whether they're students, whether they're teachers, whether they're people in your organization, whether it's the person that's the maintenance person. Communicate and let them be a part of your team, because once you get everybody on the same page, it's a beautiful thing. And we're not there at the University of Minnesota. I'm still trying to get some things worked out to get better. But to give you an example, the biggest moment I've had at the University of Minnesota wasn't winning the little brown jug in Ann Arbor, Michigan, or beating Iowa and getting the pig, or going to the bowl game for the first time since 1967. The biggest accomplishment and the biggest thing that I've had since I've been at the University of Minnesota, I got to speak at graduation. And that was a big moment for me. And I will tell you, speaking through graduation and having all the people there, all the deans, all the people of education, you'd be surprised when I walk across campus, hey, coach, how you doing? Because if they know that I care about those kids getting a college degree, they know that they want to support the football program and what's going on over here. And I will tell you, if you carry a 3.0 for seven straight semesters, that's going to help you. I will tell you that when I was at other places, we didn't have a 3.0. When you're dealing with 118 players, football players, and you get that, it's an incredible accomplishment by those young men. Because I'll tell you, the average probably across the country is about a 2.4. And it's not easy here at the University of Minnesota. It's like we can't recruit the same players that we recruited to Northern Illinois than we recruited at Minnesota or Southern Illinois, you know, because they're different cultures, different places. And, excuse me. So I think it's about the right fit where you're at. Say you're at a high school and you're in charge of one high school and you move to another high school. That culture may be completely different. You have to find out what works to motivate the culture that you're in. And if it's not a very good one, how are you going to get it changed? And if you're negative at the top, you know, it's not going to change. And I mean, I do everything I can, you know, and I think the best thing I've ever done is to sit down there and for practice, sit there outside our practice facility and have every one of those kids come by. If I had it my way, I'd put my office down in the equipment room and let somebody else have that fancy office and be down there where I can be around the players all the time. And that's what I enjoy. You know, I have passion. And I think we also have forgotten education, how important education is. Now, I'm going to put my own self on a spot here. And my daughter works in the inner city here in Minnesota. She's a special education teacher, and working in inner city is not easy. I think she gets paid like $35,000 a year. She don't care. She loves her job. She could go to the suburbs. She don't want to. She loves what she does. She's making a difference with kids. You know, I don't know what the average salary is there in Missouri for a teacher, but here's why things are all screwed up. And unfortunately, it's not going to change. Now, I can get fired in 3 years, and I can tell you, is the pressure on this job at Minnesota and coaching college football is incredible. Incredible, because you got millions of people evaluating you. If we don't put people in the stands, the other sports don't go. It's a lot of pressure. But how can you tell me a coach deserves $3 or $4 million a year and our teachers are making, my daughter's making $35,000 a year? She asked me that question, by the way. And she says, Dad, she goes, you work hard and I've watched what you do, but you know, it's hard. We don't have this and we don't have that. Well, our society, you know, puts a lot of emphasis on entertainment, sports, all those things. If I ask all of you who picked up when they pick up the paper, what do they read? Every time I speak, three quarters of the room puts up the sports page. I mean, that's the culture we live in, unfortunately. But what you're doing is much more important than what I'm doing, because you're teaching those kids at a young age and you're making them better people and you're educating them. I know, and it's hard, but I'll go back to coaching high school. I've always said that is because I think you make more of a difference in what you do. You know, sometimes we put a value on money. I would tell you that, and I make a lot of money right now, you got more problems when you make more money than you do when you don't make a lot of money. And I was just as happy at Webb City High School, and I'm not sure what I got paid. I think it was $22,000 or something like that. That was the best job and the happiest time in my life. And I enjoyed it. And I even think about how much more I enjoyed it as the years go by, because I felt like I was really, truly making a difference. So what I'm telling you all is, you know, where you're at, you're making a huge difference. If you're not in for the kids, then you shouldn't be in it. This is all about the kids. It's the only reason that I coach. You got coaches that coach for the money, and you got coaches that coach because they love kids. I love kids. I love the kids that are troubled kids. I love them all. And I can't change them all. I work very hard at it. But that's the passion that I have and the passion that you need to take into what you do. I think, you know, there's a lot of people that don't like their jobs. I mean, I can't imagine not liking what you do. I haven't worked in 32 years. I grew up in a small country town, baling hay when it was 110 degrees, and I got paid 2 cents a bale. I thought that was the biggest thing in the world. But I didn't want to do that kind of work my whole life. So I went and got an education. And with that being said, I wanted to do something I love to do. And I've been able to do it. You know, I've had a few bumps in the road, but I'm living a dream. And I'm very fortunate and very blessed, but I have worked very hard and I've listened to people that can guide me. I've listened to the people that have been before me. I always respect my elders and I've taken a nugget out of everything they've taught me. I'm a part of a lot of people. I'm a part of Ron Lankford, you know, when he was there. I'm a part of, you know, Kurt Thompson and John Roderick and Jim Paulus and Tom Gosch. I took some of those nuggets that are still with me today, but I wanted to be the best. I just didn't want to be average. I wanted to be the best that I could be at what you could do. And my dad taught me that. We're only here for so long. We just are. I don't worry about tomorrow, and you can't worry about yesterday. You got to worry about today and live today and get better today. And don't be too proud to, you know, ask for questions and want to get better. So, you know, in kind of summary, you know, putting a summary to what I've talked about, it all starts at the top, and you're only as good as the people at the top. And most of you are at the top of your profession, and you're a big influence on a lot of people, and you're making a difference. But I will tell you this. We live in a different culture than we used to. I've had to adjust my coaching and teaching right now to what it was 32 years ago. I wouldn't be here. You know, you have to adjust and understand the world has changed. And I've been able to do that. And it hasn't been easy because I'm an old school guy. But I've done an okay job. I could always do better. But I've had a lot of fun doing it, and I've been blessed. But if I could give you some key points back down the line before I retire here off this thing, is that make the tough decisions. You know, care about people. Care about the person next to you more than you care about yourself. You know, we live in an I world. We can say what we say, do, you know, but we live in an I world. You know, if you look at teams that have been successful, if you look at the San Antonio Spurs, a basketball team in the NBA, they don't have the best players, but they won NBA championships because they had the best team. So wherever you're at, wherever you're in charge of, and the school is, be the best you can be at that school. You may not have what the other school has, but the one thing you do have in your control is the people you hire, the people that you can get motivated, and you as a leader, if you're positive, your people will be positive. But if you're negative, it ain't ever going to happen. So make sure you understand, we live a short life. Have fun at what you do. Put a smile on your face and enjoy what you have, because we're all truly blessed. With that, before I go to the next session that I have to go to, is there any questions? And you can ask me anything that you would like here for a few minutes.
We've got a microphone if Jerry does. And while we're looking at the crowd to see if there are questions, Jerry, I would like for you to express your thanks to Rebecca for letting us invade your house in Minneapolis with this cast today. So tell Rebecca thank you. He's doing this from his house so that we can be with him. Let's give him a round of applause.
Thank you.
Jerry, right now I don't see we have any questions. I do personally want to thank you for doing this. And I want to tell you, sometimes we pay speakers a lot of money, and I said, Jerry, we can pay you some, not a lot. He said, I don't want anything. What he said today, he demonstrated here today, because he cares about the kids, not only in Minnesota, but the kids of Missouri. And thank you very much for that.
Thank you, and you all have a tremendous evening.